Hi, we're going to talk about Rafael Nadal. Well, he's number one in the world as of April 2011, has been for about a year and a half or 2 years now. Rafael has been interesting because when I first came on full-time on the Pro Tour, the men's side, in the year 2002, he was just starting to come up. And he wasn't really making the finals. He was winning. He was getting to the semifinals, quarterfinals. I didn't really pay a whole lot of attention, but you did notice him. And it was always the clay court tournaments at that time. So it was more the clay court season, which we're entering into now with the French Open. But then within a few years' time, by the year 2004, he was in finals. And he was winning tournaments. And he was making finals of Grand Slams. Now, because of the language situation, at that time he really didn't speak hardly any English. He could just barely communicate, and he always just had his uncle around, which Uncle Tony is his name. And there wasn't too many other people around him. There wasn't an entourage, and that went on. Now, Rafael, the thing you notice about him was he was super type A hyper personality. So whenever you would see him, he would be almost at a run, regardless of whether he was in the player lounge or he was just going to a press interview or whatever it was. He was just on the go. So it wasn't easy to just stop and have a conversation with him. And, I tried in the very early stages, and it'd be hello, goodbye, and right out the door kind of a thing. He didn't really know who I was. But what happened was that I would stay at the French Open after the finals, and he was winning the finals. He was beating Roger Federer. And I would stay in the after the finals, and Roger would come up out of the locker room into the to go to the transport, the cars. And I was about 7:30 in the evening usually. There were just four or five people in the players' lounge area. And I would stay there because I really felt it was my position to be there to say something to Roger and to get to establish that bond. Well, I knew Roger's coach very well, Tony Roach, too. And Roger would come up, or Rafael first. It just depended on the time. And I would just smile at him, shake my head, and he'd walk by. So over a period of time, he would see me, and I'm not sure what he thought. You know, who is this person? Who is he after years of seeing me? But then it was a couple years later where his English had improved, his situation had changed. All of a sudden, he started to have three or four people around him, more on a regular basis. You'd see them at different tournaments. It wasn't just Uncle Tony. And I went over to Uncle Tony and I spoke to him. I said, you know, I'm a pastor and I'm a Christian. I work with the church. And, you know, I spoke to him. He was really happy to talk to me. And this was after this was during the Australian Open. And we started up a conversation. And he told me about their background, what they believed. They're Catholics. They came from Spain. And that his grandmother, Rafael's grandmother, was a very devout churchgoer, but they weren't necessarily. But he was very happy to talk to me. And to this day, if I see him, we can have a conversation. Now, that was really the beginning stages. During that period of time, the press, and I'm always leery of reading something in the press where it doesn't involve the player actually quoting the player's direct words. Because the player's using their direct words, you know you're getting it directly from them, what's on their heart. Otherwise, it's just an interpretation. So the media was always reporting that Rafael, you know, was living with his mother and father, and that was very unusual. He was number one in the world. He had all this money, and he chose to live at home with his mother and father instead of having an apartment somewhere or a girlfriend, living with his girlfriend. And, I always thought that was a bit odd just from the standpoint of the way the press was reporting it, but okay, that's what it was. Then all of a sudden, boom, it comes out in the press. The mother and father are getting a divorce. It's not a surprise to me because I've seen, you know, where it press misrepresents players. And, probably it wasn't a great situation at home. If the mother and father are fighting or they're not getting along and they're getting ready to go through a divorce, things are tough. And so Rafael was all of a sudden caught up in that in the press, and that came out. Now, as I would see Rafael now in the last few years, he would actually look at me. I'm sure he knows who I am and what I do. He can speak English now. But, you know, the last I really spent time with him was at Cincinnati in the year 2010, the tournament there. In the nighttime, he would come in. I was in near staying at the Player Hotel. He would come in and at nighttime, and he'd get surrounded by about 15 fans, want autographs, and I'd go walk alongside him, and I'd just say, remember, God loves you, and he'd look at me, and, you know, I'm not sure how he took it, but that's what I did, and he went on, and, you know, so as he would see me, he'd just pay attention. Shanghai tournament in the year 2010. Now, it's a little bit different because he has a little bit of an entourage now. I didn't see Uncle Tony around much. His entourage, which is about six or seven people, would sit at a table separate from him. One of the entourage, who's his trainer, I actually have had contact with him for probably 10 years, and he's a committed Christian. He's been talking to me. So, you know, I know that God can send people around people, depending on our prayers. And Rafael would be sitting at the table by himself, and I'd be sitting at the table just across the way. So, you know, I didn't communicate. I didn't say anything to him. I just didn't feel it was the right time. But there's that seeing you around makes all the difference in the world. And so Rafael, we could just say, is on a journey. He has a background from a Catholic nation. He would believe in Christ. He would know about the church. I doubt if, because of his tennis playing as a youth, if he spent much time in the church or it was a very important part of his life. But you never know, actually. And finding out that his grandmother was a devout believer is also important. And we wish Rafael the best. Again, for me as a pastor and as someone who loves tennis for a long time, you know, I would just like to see that players say, this has been an important part of my life, and it's who I am. I have some faith background. It's who I am, and it's helped me. It's helped me in my personal life. It's helped me in my family life, and it's helped my tennis game. And, you know, the best we can do is pray for people. And I just ask that you lift up Rafael, especially as he's becoming a person who could be number one in the world for two or three or four more years, or however many more years it would take. But, you know, he could have a very historical influence on the game. For sure he's had that with the clay courts. And now he's winning hard court events, which is very hard to do. Clay courts and hard courts together means you're a very special player. And we just lift him up in prayer. So thank you, and thank you. We look forward to talking to you about more about players and tournaments and upcoming events.